Thank you, St. Louis. Thank you very much. I give you a good clapping. Here's one for all the chestnuts. A song I wrote in Africa last year. It's called Mombasa. Mombasa, man. Thank you. That song's called That's the Spirit. And that's the spirit. I wrote that song a long, long time ago, just before my first daughter, Amanda, was born. And I'm going to play a song for you now from my new album, which she gave the title to this particular song. She's 11 years old now, and she's quite a lady. Anyway, she knows about song titles, I can tell you that. This song's called I've Always Thought of You. It's about Dad being away on the road all the time. That was a little Chinese piece called Tu Ning. Many people ask me when I started playing. I usually say, oh, what time is it now? I started playing back in 1959. My mother and my father gave me a small, cheap guitar to get me started. You see, my mother played a bit of Hawaiian steel guitar, and so she wanted someone to go, you know. Then, you know. who better than her blonde-haired, green-eyed boy? And so she gave me this guitar. Actually, it was very fancy. It had had cowboys painted on it, sitting around the campfire with the smoke curling up like that. The Golden Boy. I don't know. I think it was one of those Sears and Roebuck, you know, 50-day get your money back and here's a free shirt to go with it type guitars, and please take it and we don't want it type deals, wasn't it? But anyway, it was a start, and the strings, of course, were only half an inch from the fretboard. I'm telling you, that was a tough start. But my brother Phil took up the guitar about the same time, and of course he became the lead player, and I became the rhythm player. And it wasn't long before we started listening to The Ventures, you know. And that Hank Marvin and the Shadows, and of course we wanted to be electric guitar players. And so we pestered our dad and said we want electric guitars. So he went out and bought these two electric guitars and came home and said, "There you are, boys, there's your electric guitars, get to work." And we said, "Thanks, Dad, where's the amp?" And Dad said, "What's an amp?" I said, "Well, you know, it's a little thing like this, and you plug a lead in here and all the sound comes out of it." "Oh, we can't afford an amp. I had to mortgage the house to buy these guitars." And so Phil and I thought about it. We thought if we pushed hard enough with the end of the neck here against Mum's walnut wardrobe, that we could get it to resonate. So we did that for a while, but of course when Dad said, "What's all these marks on the wardrobe?" and then drove 5 miles to find us hiding under a tin can, he made us resonate. And but anyway, we got the amp, ladies and gentlemen, and what an amp it was. 10 watts of sheer distortion. It was. They were fairly new with those. You turned it on and it went, it was part Aboriginal. No, but this thing did hissed and buzzed and everything, but honestly, we plugged into it and it didn't take us long to blow it up. And and blow it up we did, several times. Of course, in Australia in those days, some states had DC power and some states had AC power. Of course, we didn't know that. And we'd arrive into town like a whirling dervish ready to do our show. We'd put our gear on the stage and plug it in and go, and then everything smelt like burning something, you know. But anyway, it was a lot of fun. But the song that really got us started was a song written by the great Arthur Smith, who still plays this song. He's out there, I think he's in Florida. But I met him last year, thanks to the Chet Atkins Appreciation Society. What a thrill it was to meet and play guitar boogie with the man who wrote it. That you may as well sit down and play, you know, something with Mozart without the big hair and all the fast fingers. But I can tell you that Arthur Smith is a wonderful man, and still full of the spirit, full of vim and vigor, and he plays great too. And I'd like to attempt a version for you tonight, the St. Louis version of Guitar Boogie in the traditional fashion tonight, ladies and gentlemen, one note after the other. Here we go. Now it's a 12 bar blues in E. And if you'd like to sing along, please don't. You'll ruin the whole thing, okay? Just a bit. Don't try that on a Japanese instrument. Thank you. Like that one either. Thank you. Thank you so much. When I was 7 years old, I heard the great Chet Atkins on the radio in Australia. And it forever changed my life as a musician and set me on a course that I've never faltered from. When I first heard him, I could hear that he was playing the bass part, the rhythm part, and the melody part all at the same time. And most people in Australia in those days thought it was a recording trick. And I don't know whether a lot of people over here thought it too. Probably a lot of people did, you know. Because, you know, Les Paul was very innovative in those days, and there was one guitar player playing 16 parts. It was very brilliant and well ahead of its time. But Chet did do this, and it was Chet who I heard first doing that, and then I heard Merle Travis. And but when I heard that, I just had to work out what was going on. And I started off with a plectrum, and it wasn't until I bought the album, The Best of Chet Atkins, where there was a photo of him on the cover with a sort of dark greeny colored Gretsch, I saw this thing on his thumb. Ah, and it wasn't a wart. yes. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I know that there are many musicians in St. Louis, and there's probably quite a few in the auditorium this evening. I'm going into my radio voice now. My very, very good friends in radio. No. and what I'm hoping to do tonight is inspire you to whiz home and take that guitar out from under the bed or from on top of the wardrobe, or just pull the pot plant out of the middle and put some strings on it again. You know? Mr. Sheen it up. So I'm hoping that you're going to be inspired. Now, I just want to spend a few minutes to give you, and this is at a great expense to the management here. I'm doing this, by the way. It's included, something you buy. It's included in your ticket price this evening is a short guitar lesson. And so I would, thank you, ma'am. I would suggest that you rush out immediately. Well, not right this minute, stay here because we're in the middle of the show. But you know, tomorrow when you get up and dust off that guitar, whiz out to a music shop and say, I want one of those thumb picks like I saw that fellow Tony Enamel from Australia. I want to get one of Tony's picks. Isn't it funny? Like, my name's Tommy, right? And that's an easy name to remember. But you'd be amazed how many people come up and say, you know, and they've been coming to my shows for years, and they say, gee, it was good tonight, Tony. You know, sincerely. So I end up calling myself Tony Enamel for a while. And not too many people have made that mistake. It's usually in Italy where they go, hey, Tony Emmanuel. But you can't actually make out whether it's Tommy or Tony. So, anyway. I'll be playing in Italy very soon, and the thing I like about Italy is the catering. Man, I mean, I come back looking like Pavarotti. Oh! Where was I? Oh, yes, I was giving you a lesson. I didn't mean to rush past that. Boom, boom, thank you. Sorry, I didn't mean to speak your linguini. These are just coming off the top of my head, you know. So here's what you've got to do. See, what I'm doing up here is what I worked out when I was a kid, and that is that your thumb has to be independent from the fingers. And let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't done this before, you're going to find out what a rebellious digit this thing is. Right? This thing does not want to do what you actually want to do. So what you've got to do is start out by putting your fingers on the face of the guitar like that, down on the scratch guard. Rest just the edge of your heel like that, so you slightly mute the string. And now, get the thumb to go like this on its own. Now that doesn't look too tough, does it? It's not. I promise you, it'll only take a couple of weeks. So, you practice this until your thumb swells up and goes blue. The dog starts howling, and your wife leaves you. That's pretty much, then you'll know you got it right. Oh, are you serious? No. So, you do this for a while, and then when you think you've got a bit of independence going, then you keep your little finger down and allow the other three digits up, like this. Then they join in the dance. Now, we've got to get independence between thumb and fingers. So, we play a chord per bar, like this. The thumb has to keep going, okay? And it won't want to. Okay? Now, once you've got that down, the police will be driving by checking breath tests. The dogs run off with a cat next door, and your wife's gone to Alaska. So, then you'll know you're really getting somewhere. Okay, so now we put a little accent, a little skip beat at the end of each bar, like this. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the beginning of independence. You can do this till the 4th of July. Okay, when you can do that, you start to get a feel for it, right? Then you learn a song and put all this good work into music. Now, the first song that I heard Chet play was a tune called Trambone, and I'm not going to play that tonight. I'm going to play a song written by John D. Loudermilk, and he told me himself that he wrote this song for Chet. Chet had been recording a lot of jazz-influenced music and wanted to kind of wind his way back to country. So he wrote this little piece. It's right in the middle. It's bluesy. It has a little country, has a little jazz, a little in it. So I'm going to it for you now. Here we go. Windy and warm. Can't wait to hear it myself. Thank you. Well, now I'm going to show you something else here. I'm going to swing the bass part like a jazz bass player now and play the melody and the rhythm at the same time while learning two Oriental languages. This is a Paul Williams tune called Just an Old Fashioned Love Song. Hope you like this arrangement. I borrowed the bass part from Elvis's Ooh, Baby, Let Me Be Your Edward Bear. I'm going to show you something else here. I'm going to swing the bass part like a jazz bass player now and play the melody and the rhythm at the same time while learning two Oriental languages. This is a Paul Williams tune called Just an Old Fashioned Love Song. Hope you like this arrangement. I borrowed the bass part from Elvis's Ooh, Baby, Let Me Be Your Edward Bear. Thank you. Here's a song from my new album. The album's called Only, and the reason it's called that is because that's what my partner said we should call it. No, because it's a solo acoustic album. It's the first one I've ever made, and I hope you like it when you hear it. But this is the first track on the album. Ladies and gentlemen, we learn so much in life, don't we? I mean, life is our teacher. Life is the school, and if we're smart, we learn the lessons and learn from each other. And I think one of the hardest things that I've ever had to learn is patience and trust and faith and in believing that things are going to work out. That's really hard to learn, to be patient. And that's what this song's all about truly trusting that if your motives are right and everything about you is heading in the right direction and your motives are right, then there's no way that you can go wrong. And so that's what this song's about. It's called Those Who Wait. I'd like to play it for everybody in the room tonight. Thank you. As I said earlier in the evening, I'm from Australia, a beautiful country, the other side of the world, and the more I come to your beautiful country, the more I like it too. And I feel very much at home here. And the warm welcome that I've received is almost overwhelming. And I really mean this when I say how much I truly appreciate it. And how much fun it is to come and play for you here. Thank you. Same to you. I wrote a song, and I'd like to play it for you tonight. This song tells a story of an Aboriginal ceremony. And I make all these sounds on my white man's thunder stick. And I hope you enjoy this. It's called Initiation. Don't be scared. Be very scared.
Thank you.
Thank you. The story of Waltzing Matilda goes back a long way. It's the actual melody is from a Scottish song. I don't know what it's called. I should know, but hey, I don't know everything. But Banjo Paterson wrote the words, and it's a beautiful, beautiful song. There's words like swagman, what you would call a hobo, and there's a billabong, which is like a pond. It's a little eco, self-contained pond where there's sometimes very clean water, sometimes crocodiles in there, fish in there, all sorts of bird life, fish life, and that's called a billabong. And a coolabah tree, that's a type of tree we have in Australia. And he sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. And a billy is a tin can that we used to carry around, that a hobo carries to boil his water in, to make his tea. He puts it on the fire. When the water boils, he throws the tea leaves in, takes it off the fire, and puts a gum leaf in as well, to give it a little different flavor. Things like that. Anyway, I'll sing Waltzing Matilda, and I think you'll get the gist of the story. Once a jolly swagman camped by a billabong under the shade of a coolabah tree. And he sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. Who'll come a waltzing Matilda with me? Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, who'll come a waltzing Matilda with me? And he sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. Who'll come a waltzing Matilda with me? Up came a jumbuck as a sheep to drink at the billabong. Up jumped the swagman and he grabbed him with glee. And he sang as he shoved that jumbuck in his tucker bag. You'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. And he sang as he shoved that jumbuck in his tucker bag. You'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. Up came the squatter, mounted on his thoroughbred. Up came the troopers, one, two, three. Where's that jolly jumbuck that you've got in that tucker bag? You'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. Where's that jolly jumbuck that you've got in your tucker bag? You'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. Up jumped the swagman and he sprang into the billabong. You'll never take me alive, said he. And his ghost may be heard as you pass by that billabong. Greatest thrill of my life a few years ago. I had the incredible honor of recording an album with my mentor, Chet Atkins. And when we were writing songs and coming up with music that we thought we might want to put on the album, of course the great criteria of any recording by Chet is melody. And I heard this song on the radio and I started playing it as an instrumental, and I played it to him over the phone, and he said, "That's one right there, so I want to play it for you." It's a Julian Lennon song called Salt Water.
Thank you.
Good night, folks. Thank you. I just have one more thing that I had to do before I said good night, and that was this. Thank you so much.